Live from Washington, you're watching Access Point, and I'm Ayesha Tanzeem. Hello and welcome. The opening of a new Taliban political office in Doha was going to help Washington and Kabul sit down with the Taliban. Instead, it made Kabul furious when Taliban hoisted their flag and a banner announced them as the Islamic Republic of Afghanistan. Now that the flag and banner are down, will Kabul return to the table and under what conditions? Joining us in the studios are Afghanistan experts Dr. Thomas Lynch of the National Defense University and Ahmed Majid Yar of American Enterprise Institute. And we are hoping that soon from Kabul we'll have Mr. Mohammad Ismail Qasimyar, who will join us either via Skype or via telephone. We are trying him as of now. He's the international advisor to the Afghan High Peace Council. And Sara Zaman is standing by on our social media desk. She'll be bringing in your comments in our discussion. Welcome everyone to the show. I want to start with you, Dr. Lynch. This was the first demand of Kabul and also Washington. The Taliban office in Qatar was going to be only a political office. They were not going to call themselves anything that looked remotely like a government, but they did. How serious are they about talks?
Yes, well, thank you, Isha. Very delighted to be here today again and on, you know, behalf of my institute for expressing my own personal opinions as opposed to those of the U.S. government or the Department of Defense. I do think you've hit the nail on the head. I think the earnestness and the seriousness of the Taliban as being engaged in these talks really has been put in question by the degree of the spectacle that occurred in Qatar when they opened the office. As you may recall, and some of your viewers may recall, this office was proposed to be stood up way back in 2010, 2011. There was an abortive effort to stand it up in late 2011 that foundered over what would be discussed, what wouldn't. There was another interim period earlier this year when it was going to be stood up. So I think it was clear that the basis for negotiation would be that the Taliban was a political entity, not a oppositional entity to the Islamic Republic of Afghanistan. So by declaring itself representative of the Islamic Emirate, putting it in opposition to the current constitution, the current government, it really was a case of putting Kabul in a position of not being able to say yes to talks at this point.
And let me just point out that this is the exact name they used before 9/11 when they were in government in Kabul, although most of the world didn't recognize it. So this is almost like a simultaneous embassy. Emma, what I want to ask you is, when I earlier talked to Mr. Qasimyar, who we hope will join us soon, and other members of the High Peace Council, they were furious. They were furious that this has happened. They said that Washington assured us. They've pulled out of the talks. These talks are going to be Afghan-owned, Afghan-led. Now we are hearing that the special representative of Afghanistan and Pakistan, Mr. James Dobbins, might talk to Taliban in the next few days because they've taken down the banner and the flag. Will Kabul return to the talks?
I think that at this point there is a lot of uncertainty. Today the Taliban indeed just threatened to boycott the talks. And although you mentioned that the Taliban has removed the billboard with their official name from the building and the flag, but other reports suggest that they have hoisted their flag again. So in my opinion, the Taliban opened the Qatar office not for the purpose of just to find a political settlement with the Afghan government or with the United States to end the conflict peacefully, but they had other agendas. And first of all, this was a big publicity stunt for the Taliban because their office, as you described before, it resembled more an embassy in exile. So it benefits the Taliban, first of all, to just communicate with international media. It helps them to gain legitimacy and also increase their credibility in the region. 2 weeks before the opening of the Qatar office, a senior delegation of the Taliban, they traveled to Iran, and there are also reports that they are trying to open similar offices in Saudi Arabia, in other Gulf regions. So for the Taliban, they have a lot to gain from these negotiations, but I don't think that they are serious about finding any political settlement.
Now, I'm going to come to this point about them trying to open other offices, but as Mr. Ahmed Majid Yar said, they have a lot to gain from these negotiations. What role should Taliban have in these negotiations? Let's go over to our social media desk, where Sara Zaman's waiting. You have left some opinion. Let's hear it.
Right, Ayesha. So since the chatter about a dialogue with the Afghan Taliban is getting louder, we wanted to know what, if any, role our viewers think Taliban should have in Afghanistan's future. Now, Saliha Siddiqui says no role for Taliban. They misuse religion to achieve their goals and their acts further perpetuate the negative image that has been created about Islam. Arif Bangar says, I'm now convinced the Taliban are those Pashtuns which were and are used against invaders through religious radicalization. He says the new trend now is to promise them independence, economic benefits and a stable Afghanistan and then use them as paid fighters against other groups or nations. But Nawaz Shelly here points out that any decision regarding the role of Taliban in the region should be left up to the Afghan people. He says if Taliban are given the space they deserve, then we can expect them to play a positive role. We also had the chance to speak to a couple of people on the streets of Islamabad. Let's hear their thoughts on this question.
Yes, obviously, they were elected people. So they have a role, and diplomatically, yes. And obviously, they are resisting, so they have another role, which they are playing actively.
We should accept them. We should accept them that they are force, that they are people. I think if you sit with them, I don't think that there is any harm.
So mixed views from our commenters on whether Taliban should have any role in Afghanistan's future. If you would like to share your opinion, talk to us on Facebook at Access Point with AT or join the VOA Urdu page. Now back to Ayesha and our experts.
Thank you very much, Sarah. Those opinions, I must point out, are from Islamabad. The opinion in Kabul might be different. But as you said, one of the things that the High Peace Council is saying, how is Washington allowing this? How's Washington allowing them behave almost like they're working out of an embassy? They took a trip to Iran. This office is legitimate. They're being allowed to operate, Dr. Lynch.
Well, I think we need to be careful here to not just point fingers at Washington. I mean, clearly there is a point of concern that's legitimate from the High Peace Council and from Minister Karzai. By the same token, however, there are other players that matter in this. And I want to highlight the role of Pakistan in all of this. I think Pakistan's role has been increasingly forthcoming and somewhat helpful. And I think today there are some signs, some reports that the government in Islamabad has expressed concern and has not endorsed the manner in which the Taliban have opened their office in Qatar and says it legitimately recognizes the status of the Karzai government. Now that's an advance forward. Maybe it's just because of Nawaz Sharif, or maybe it's because of some other parties and players. So I think here the Taliban have overreached. And perhaps the sentiments of dismay on the part of how this has happened now need to be recalculated on the part of the Taliban. I think it's important to analyze here, though, that if we think the Taliban has not been diplomatically engaged in different countries around the world, even without an office, we're kidding ourselves. I mean, they have been attempting to reestablish legitimacy. They have been trying to establish their positions. But I think the key point here is they can't come out and declare themselves the Islamic Emirate of Afghanistan and not be in direct opposition to the criteria, the three criteria that have been long stated as the conditions under which talks would occur. U.S. endorsed, Kabul established, and that is renunciation of al-Qaeda, that is laying down of arms and stopping the armed insurgency, and third is acknowledging the legitimacy of the Constitutional Republic of Afghanistan. They have not done that at this point, therefore they have no right to expect
negotiations. And they have not also accepted that there's a government that exists in Kabul, and we have a member of the High Peace Council joining us via telephone, Mr. Mohammad Ismail Qasimyar. Mr. Qasimyar, welcome to the show. Okay, so I'm told that his line has dropped again, so we'll get back to him, Mr. Majidyar. I want to come to you. The question is, okay, so this fiasco happened. Now there's a possibility of talks. We don't know whether they're happening or not, but one of the things that was going to be discussed was the release of some prisoners from Guantanamo, or at least moving them to Qatar. Do you think that might happen?
Well, first of all, I'd like to just highlight the fact that, as Dr. Lane just mentioned before, that it's not just that the talks with the Taliban just started now. Both the Obama and the Karzai administrations over the past years have tried actively to engage the Taliban diplomatically to find a solution to the Afghan war. But unfortunately, what we see from the Taliban has been only increased violence. They have refused to accept the Afghan government and Afghan constitution. They have refused to cut ties with al-Qaeda and also renounce violence. So we shouldn't have a lot of expectations from their opening of office in Qatar, because there have been a lot of negotiations before as well without any results. And coming back to your point about release of prisoners, I think that the Taliban has two main objectives from opening of Qatar. One is that, as you mentioned, is the release of 5 top Taliban prisoners from Guantanamo Bay in return for one American soldier
yes.
who is now held captive by the Taliban. So this has always been one of their priorities. And secondly, they also want to engage the Americans to convince the United States to withdraw its troops faster and also to not to leave behind any residual forces after 2014. So this is one of their main objectives.
Which America is trying to do now. Mr. Qasim Yar, Mohammed Ismail Qasim Yar of the High Peace Council is with us from Kabul. Mr. Qasim Yar, welcome to the show. Mr. Qasim Yar, can you hear me?
Yes, thank you, yes.
Mr. Qasim Yar, we were just talking about the way Taliban opened the office and announced themselves as the Islamic Republic, Islamic Emirate of Afghanistan. Now that they've taken down the flag and banner, do you think there's any chance Kabul might return to the table to talk to them?
Unfortunately, the content of the opening ceremony was designed not to be helpful for peace talks.
Mr. Qasim Yar, let me interrupt you just for a second. Your phone line is really, really bad, so I'll request our producers to dial you again. We can hardly understand you. I apologize for that. We'll get right back to you as soon as they dialed you again and we can hear you properly. But let me come back to what we were talking about. Dr. Lynch, why should the Taliban at this point talk to either the U.S. or the Afghan government? Analyst after analyst has said they can just wait it out. The U.S. is leaving in 2014.
Well, I mean, that certainly is one approach that they could take. I think it's important to put in context a couple of things that are going on here. Because I think, you know, as usual in South Asia, when one side overplays its hand, the other side can benefit from it. And I think we miss a turn if we don't see what's happened in Qatar as really kind of playing into the hands of Karzai, you know, and the American position if done right. First and foremost, the Taliban right now are very uncertain, as is the rest of the region, as to how far and how fast U.S. withdrawal and Western withdrawal in Afghanistan will take place. Okay, the transition of combat operations has occurred, but there still is a verbal commitment lodged firmly in Chicago in 2010 and carried forward to this date that there will be a residual Western military presence to help the Afghan National Army cleave together, to help train it, to help mentor it, and to help provide the necessary logistic support and to provide a resistance point for the return of any type of a global terrorist organization to Afghanistan. Okay? That still is to be settled out. And the Taliban needed to have recognized that process, I think, a little better than they did, because they must understand, they surely should have understood, that by declaring themselves a representative of the old Afghanistan Emirate, that there is no basis for negotiation from that. And in the process, what they've done is they've kind of flipped the tables back on themselves, I think we'll see here, and I think the statement of Nawaz Sharif's government amplifies that, that this was a mistake. Even Pakistan recognizes the legitimacy of the Afghan government of Karzai. So from a little over 6 months ago, where the U.S. looked like it was obstructionist for not being willing to talk about the release of certain prisoners from Guantanamo, now it's the Taliban that look obstructionist by refusing to allow themselves to be a political party that could fit into the Islamic Republic of Afghanistan.
Now, while we continue discussion and trying to call Mr. Qasim Yar back, let's go over to our social media desk again, because we asked some of you what role Taliban should have and should Taliban talk to the U.S. Sarah?
Right, Ayesha, we asked the same question of our viewers too, that if the Taliban and the U.S. have been fighting for over a decade in Afghanistan, why should the Taliban consider talking to the U.S. at this point? Now, I want to share a quick video comment with our viewers first, and then we'll move to online comments.
I'd say dialogue is a necessity, because after every war in the world, dialogue actually necessary to maintain the situation. Otherwise, it exploit, and exploitation at what extent?
After all, and on our social media platforms, I'm seeing a lot of yes and no to this dialogue. Ayesha Bibi says Taliban should not consider engaging in talks with the U.S. America shouldn't be given a safe exit. They came here on their own, but they will leave Afghanistan on Taliban's terms. And Sajjad Ahmed Mughal agrees. He says Taliban should not engage in a dialogue until America rebuilds Afghanistan entirely. But Mohammed Tahir Saleem says Taliban should hold talks with the U.S. He says they were never on America's list of terror groups until they got involved with Al-Qaeda.
the self-imposed alienation of the Afghan government, he says, shows that it's an interim arrangement created by the U.S. And he says this also acknowledges Taliban as a major stakeholder in Afghanistan. Now, many who are in favor of the Afghan-Taliban talks to the U.S. also feel that a positive outcome will help Pakistan become more peaceful and safe. For more discussion, let's go back to Ayesha.
Thank you very much, Sarah. I didn't understand what he meant by self-imposed alienation. I don't think Karzai's government is alienated, but Mr. Majidyar, is it inside the country?
Well, the views that I've seen over the past 2 days from the Afghan media, from the Afghan talk shows, and from the Afghan people has been quite different from what we see from Islamabad. Of course, the country has been in 34 years of perpetual war. So majority of the Afghans, they want peace, but they don't want peace at the price of losing all the gains that they have made over the past 11 years, be it human rights, women's rights, democracy, elections, and other developments in the civil society as well. They want to talk to the Taliban, but not a reestablishment of the Taliban back in Afghanistan. And also there were a great deal of concern and anxiety over the past 2 days, both inside the Afghan government and also amongst the Afghan people, that the Qatar office, the way that it was opened, that, as you described before, this means a recognition of the Taliban as a government in exile, or at least as a legitimate armed opposition movement, not a terrorist movement. And also there are fears that this could somehow be used as an excuse by the West to withdraw Afghanistan the way that it abandoned the country after the Soviet collapse in 1991. So a repetition of all the civil war and all the atrocities that happened in the 1990s.
That's a very important point. That's been the fear all along, hasn't it? That the U.S. will leave the way it left after the Soviet invasion. It will pick up its bags and just go. And the Taliban can just wait it out and the country will go right back to a civil war, Dr. Lynch.
Well, certainly this is the concern. But I think the concern has to be put in context of the present. And here, some of the machinations out of Kabul are understandable, but some are self-defeating. And that context is, again, as I point back to, there's a commitment on the part of the West and on the part of the majority of NATO countries to remain present in Afghanistan beyond 2014, not to just cut, run, and exit, but rather to remain with some force. And that force has been the subject of a negotiation process, which is now a bilateral U.S. Karzai government process to determine how much and how long. But everybody's been talking about the how much as being on the order of tens of thousands, not single or hundreds of troops, and for a protracted period of time, say through the end of this decade. All right? Now, the inability, though, to come to a completed bilateral security arrangement between the United States and Afghanistan could leave a self-fulfilling prophecy of Afghanistan being abandoned and being left alone. And here, Mr. Karzai has taken some risk, which I strongly encourage him to reconsider, you know, once the heat of the moment has expired, and return to this bilateral negotiation so there can be establishment of this longer-term process, which, again, would reinforce the legitimacy of the current Republic government and put the Islamic Emirate of the Taliban on notice that it is not a government in opposition that has any recognition or standing in Afghanistan.
And this bilateral security arrangement that you were talking about was another victim of this opening.
That's
Mr. Karzai
right.
Can I just quickly add something
to the bilateral security agreement and just the importance of that? Because, yeah, there has been verbal commitment both by NATO and also the United States for post-2014 future of the country. But unfortunately, there is no legal framework for such a presence after 18 months. Because the United States has not yet signed the bilateral security agreement with Kabul, and also President Obama has not announced that how many troops he intends to leave behind after that the combat mission ends. So that's why there are a lot of concerns, and which has had a lot of negative implication. And one of that is that you see that a lot of ethnic minority leaders who suffered under the Taliban in the 1990s, they are rearming their militias and starting to disconnect from the central government.
Tell me something. You read Afghan media a lot. You talk to people inside the country a lot. This concern that I was mentioning that U.S. is going to up and leave, how prevalent is it inside Afghanistan?
This is quite prevalent because they just when you talk to the Afghans, they again go back and talk about what happened after the Soviet withdrawal from the country, that the West completely abandoned. And as Dr. Lynch mentioned, right now the situation is different. The United States and also NATO country, they have expressed commitment to Afghanistan that they will not leave behind Afghanistan the way it did before. until the Afghan security forces and the Afghan government are capable to defend the country's territory against the Taliban and Al-Qaeda. But unfortunately, until that this kind of verbal commitment translates into a legal framework that the Afghans see, believe in that, I think that the concerns will remain. So that's why it's important for Washington to put that verbal commitment into paper and sign this security bilateral agreement with Kabul as soon as possible, and also announce that how many troops they will leave behind, because that will send a very strong message both to friends and enemies in the region.
Right. Well, here it has been some of the sabotage, understandable, that has come by way of this kind of spectacular opening in Doha, Qatar, because that negotiation process had been going on in earnest the last several weeks and even a couple of months between Kabul and Washington. And that now is something that Karzai, in understandable frustration, has said he's putting on the back burner. I think Washington is very amenable to striking a deal here, and the Karzai government should be amenable as well. And so I'm very hopeful that after having made this statement of frustration, which is understandable, there will be, you know, a retraction from Matt, anchored on the fact that the United States stands firm in support of an Islamic Republic and will not negotiate with a representative of an emirate like the Taliban wish to claim. And likewise, I point back to the very helpful statement by the Pakistani government yesterday, indicating that it recognizes the government, the Republic of Afghanistan, as the legitimate government there, thereby putting the Taliban on notice that it is not being supported in its quest for a return to an emirate.
Now, we're all talking about these talks as if the talks are going to go forward and the talks are going to succeed to some end. What if the talks fail, Mr. Majidyar? What scenario are we looking at then?
I believe that the talk will fail. I don't see that the Taliban hardliners, Mullah Omar and his close associates, would be willing to accept the Afghan constitution and try to seek power through election. First of all, the Taliban is not a popular movement in Afghanistan. It cannot win power through elections. Secondly, they also do not believe in elections because they believe that the legitimacy comes from God. So the representative of the Taliban that we see in Qatar, we are even not sure that they really represent the leadership of the Taliban.
Aren't they supposed to be very close to Mullah Omar? Or that's what I've read.
One of the representatives was close to Mullah Omar back in 1990s, but we don't know yet, Mr. Agha, we don't know if he still is very much close to Mullah Omar or not.
So this is a very interesting point. This has happened before to the U.S., to NATO. How do we know that the people that they're talking to actually represent the Taliban that they want to talk to?
Well, that's very hard to determine. And one of the answers that I tend to give those that I talk with and my students is that, you know, you need to understand the fundamental premise here that the insurgency of Taliban in Afghanistan does not succeed without having a point of refuge outside of Afghanistan's borders. And so here, I think we need to look carefully at what the country of Pakistan is or is not indicating concerning what it would like to see as happening. That's why I think the announcement yesterday was a very important announcement. It was indicative of the fact, openly indicative of the fact, the government of Pakistan does not want to see a return of the emirate to Afghanistan, right? It doesn't want to see that return. It does, however, continue to say that it wishes to see more historic representation of certain ethnicities in the demography of Afghanistan. I think that is a now on the table point of discussion for moving forward once we get the representatives of the Taliban and Qatar to pull down the flag for good and stop making these false presentations as though they are somehow a legitimate government in exile.
Okay, let's find out what the people think about the talks and if they succeed or fail. Let's go back to Sara Zaman. Sara, what are people saying?
Aisha, considering the uncertainty surrounding the dialogue, we also asked our commenters how they think a failure to hold successful talks could affect America's plan to exit Afghanistan by 2014. Now, most people on our social media think that nothing will disrupt America's departure from Afghanistan. Allah Bakhsh Kalachi says, once America makes a policy, it ensures the implementation as well. America has decided to leave Afghanistan and it will make sure that that happens. Talks don't have much meaning for them. Sayyid Zedi Aquarian thinks the talks are only to fool the people. Taliban and America, he says, have joined hands and Taliban won't delay America's departure. And Rizwan Ahmed says, bottom line for the U.S. is to get a deal on the safety of its military bases in Afghanistan. They don't care about the rest of the country, he says. And as for the withdrawal, American soldiers will fly out and the military equipment will be carried out by a Pakistani or an Afghan driver. If the trucks are attacked, only the driver will be killed who is not NATO personnel. Now let's also take a look at what some of our video commenters said about this.
I think the failure will have disastrous consequences.
میرے خیال میں اب یہ ناکام نہیں ہوں گے کیونکہ امریکہ چاہے گا کہ ہر ان کی شرائط جتنی بھی ہیں میکسیمم مان لی جائے اور ان کے ساتھ مذاکرات کو کامیاب کیا جائے اور طالبان بھی یہی چاہیں گے کہ وہ اس کو پیسفل ہو جائے ریجن سارا.
Our last commenter was hopeful that America will try to accept all possible demands and Taliban would also try to make the dialogue a success so the region can be peaceful. To read more comments and share your thoughts with us, just log on to Facebook and then either come to Access Point with AT or VOA Urdu's Facebook page.
Thank you very much, Sara. Now, to the last point that Taliban would also want to make dialogue, as Mr. Majidyar said before the comments, the Taliban will not accept the Afghan constitution. And the Afghan government will not accept it unless they accept the constitution. So is there going to be a dialogue?
I think it's reasonable to be pessimistic about the prospects for a successful conclusion of the talks in any near-term period of time. I do, however, point back to the fact that whether it be a precondition or an intermediate condition, any Taliban that wishes to participate for the foreseeable future in the governance structure in Afghanistan is going to have to come in under the rubric of acknowledgement of the Republic of Afghanistan and fitting under that structure. I think, again, this clear statement by the Pakistani government yesterday is fully indicative of the fact that whoever in the Taliban thought they would might perhaps get support lodged has found that that's not the case right now in Islamabad. So I do believe we should not be chary and thinking it's going to happen fast,
but
I think it can happen.
What about their trip to Iran, though? Could they get support from other, not Pakistan, but other regions?
I have no doubt they went to Iran perhaps to see if perhaps them saying that, you know, their return to Afghanistan could assure the Americans are gone and trying to see if that would, you know, be more in the interest of the Iranians. I think it's very hard to conclude that the Iranians are providing them any type of in-depth support because the history here is not good. And the real interaction between the Shia-led government in Afghanistan and the militarized Taliban is not good now, nor will it be good in the future.
Mr. Majidyar, he seems to think that the Taliban will come into the fold. You, however, thought that they will not. How do you see it playing out come 2014?
Well, the Taliban has fought both the international forces and also the Afghan government over the past 12 years. And as I mentioned, despite engagement offers by Washington and Kabul, they have refused to just even talk to the Afghan government. So now that most of the foreign troops are set to withdraw from the country in 18 months, there are no incentives for the Taliban to lay down arms and join
even
a peace process.
Even if, as he pointed out, Pakistan's indicating it will not support...
The problem with Pakistan, with Pakistan's stance is that the Pakistani civilian government since 2008 has always been supportive of the Afghan government in Kabul. But the real foreign policy of Pakistan is not run by the civilian government, and especially when it comes to the support for the Taliban, that goes to the military establishment, especially the ISI. And the ISI stance is very much different from what officially we hear from the civilian government.
Is that the feeling in America, that even today ISI stance is different, or is there a change?
I think most of us who study carefully the region understand that there is a divergence between the position of the civilian government and the Pakistan military and ISI complex. Having said that, it is true that I think the Pakistan military and the ISI have divergent interests in Afghanistan, and their primary interest is not to see Indian ascendancy or Indian dominance in Afghanistan, which they, rightly or wrongly, perceive has happened over the last decade with the ascendance of the Kabul government. Now, having said all that, however, there is no indication that that ISI military prefer a return to an Islamic emirate under this current group of Taliban. And as a consequence, I think if there can be space found and if there can be some progress amongst certain Taliban factions, then Pakistan military and ISI will be certainly willing to pit some of those against others to get incremental gains as opposed to absolute or holistic gains. And that's what I pin not a false optimism on, but rather a concerted realism about things that will take time to progress, but that can progress if we see things and we see Pakistan willing to work in that
fashion. Now, I have so many more questions, but unfortunately, our time is up. I want to thank our guests, Afghanistan experts Dr. Thomas Lynch of the National Defense University and Mr. Ahmed Majidyar of American Enterprise Institute. And I want to thank you for watching. Please make sure and check out our website, urduvoa.com. And if you want to leave us comments, come to our Facebook pages, Access Point with AT or VOA Urdu. Also follow us on Twitter. We'll give you all the updates. Until next time, goodbye. Thank you so much.